What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. If you're a software developer or you're studying a programming language, you may have heard of dependency injection. Personally, at first, I thought this must be very hard, and maybe you did as well. But I assure you, it's just a fancy term used to represent a very easy concept. You see, in any object-oriented language, classes and objects are the foundations of any functionality you can think of. Now, the relationships between these classes and objects, like composition or inheritance, make it possible to extend and reuse some of these functionalities. However, there's a catch. The way that we choose to build those relationships, those dependencies, determine how decoupled and reusable our code will be. Not only in terms of our actual code, but also in terms of testing. So, suppose we have this food interface implemented by the burger class. And well, these two are being used by the chef class, which has a single method called prepareFood. In this simple example, we can notice that the chef class is dependent on the burger class, as without initializing it in the constructor, the chef cannot prepare anything. Now, imagine another chef shows up, but this one specializes in pizzas. So we created a pizza class to account for this and made it implement the food interface. In the current implementation we have, to include pizzas in the prepare food method, we will either have to get rid of the burger option permanently and stick with pizzas, or we will have to duplicate the code we have, get rid of the method we wrote entirely, and create two methods, one for each food type we are trying to prepare in the chef class. Wait, actually, some might even say we can have multiple chef classes that extend the initial one, where each one specializes in a particular type of food. Well, you kind of get where I'm going with this. All of these solutions are pretty bad. And the best thing we can do here is pass a food argument to this chef object while it is being instantiated. So, if we create a chef object while passing to it a burger object, then we have a chef that specializes in burgers, and so on. What we did here is passing the dependency to the constructor of the dependent object while it is being instantiated. This is called dependency injection. This dependency was injected into the object instead of being created inside it. We decoupled the construction of the chef class from the construction of its dependencies, the food class in this example. Previously, when we created a chef class, a food object was being instantiated automatically in its constructor because we needed it. And if a Java class creates an instance of another class via the new operator, it cannot be used and tested independently from this class. It becomes tied to this class and open for modification. And this is called a hard dependency. However, when we used dependency injection, the dependent class was no longer a concern to us, as it is provided from the outside. This way, if the object's implementation changes in the future, it is no longer the dependent class' responsibility to figure out what actually changed. Okay, with that said, you need to know that there are actually three types of dependency injection. The constructor injection, which is the one we just saw, the setter injection, and the field injection. Let's break them down. In the constructor injection, the dependencies are provided through a class constructor. In the example you see, we provided the class we depend on via the constructor while initializing our main object. This type of injection is the most recommended, and we'll see why in a bit. For the setter injection, the client exposes a setter method that the injector uses to inject the dependency. So, instead of having the dependency as a constructor parameter, we will have a setter to pass it. In this example, to create our object, we made use of the default constructor, and after that we used our setter to provide that class its dependency. However, this approach is not really recommended because, you see, by doing that, we hided that dependency. And by reading the constructor signature or creating our main object, we cannot identify that there is a dependency right away, which might cause a null pointer exception at runtime. And finally, there is a third way to inject dependencies in Java, and it is called field injection. The only way for field injection to work is either directly mutate the field, because it's a non-private and non-final field, or modify a final/private field using reflection. This approach has the same problem we discussed in the setter injection approach, and additionally it adds complexity due to the mutation or reflection required. Okay, Now that we know what is dependency injection and how to inject our dependencies, let's see, why do we even want to do that? Why would you want to apply dependency injection? Well, to answer this question, we will have to take a look at the concept behind dependency injection, called inversion of control. Inversion of control is a principle in software engineering which transfers the control of objects or portions of a program to a container or framework. You see, in contrast with traditional programming in which our custom code makes calls to a library where reusable code sits, inversion of control enables a framework to take control over the flow of a program and make calls to our custom code. To enable this, frameworks use abstractions. So, if we want to add our own behavior, we need to extend the classes of the framework or plug in our own classes. This is also reflected in the fifth principle of SOLID, which are the five basic principles of object-oriented programming and design. This principle states that a class should depend on abstractions and not on concretions. And that is exactly what we did when we injected the food class to the chef class, if you recall. With a hard-dependent code, our chef class was dependent on the implementation, or the burger class. However, when we used dependency injection, we became dependent on the abstraction, or the interface, instead of the concretion. You see, a class should concentrate on fulfilling its responsibilities and not on creating objects that are required to fulfill those responsibilities. And that's where dependency injection comes into play. It provides the class with these required objects. By doing this, you'll be reducing boilerplate and duplicate code as the initialization of the dependencies is done by the injector component. Additionally, extending the application and its functionality becomes easier. Your classes are now way more open for extension and closed for modification. Moreover, you will find greater ease in testing your program, because your dependencies can now be isolated and mocked, allowing components to communicate through contracts. Now, given all of this, I would like to point that dependency injection is a solution to certain problems. So, before applying it, start by asking yourself if you even have a problem in the first place. If not, then using it will most likely make the code worse. You have to consider, first, if you can reduce or eliminate dependencies, or if mocking will really facilitate your testing, or if it will obstruct it. As an example, suppose you have a class A which uses another class B internally. B is only used by A, and therefore fully encapsulated, and can be considered an implementation detail. If you change this to inject B into the constructor of A, then you have exposed this implementation detail, and B has to exist in some other place in the system separately from A, leading to an overall worse architecture with leaking concerns. Another problem you may encounter is while testing. Suppose you have a class B injected into the constructor of A, and while testing A, you mocked B. Now, even though your tests are passing, you will never be fully sure that the actual production code of A will work with the actual production code of B, because all you used was a mock. So, my last words on this topic are that dependency injection should be used whenever you deem it necessary, as sometimes you might find yourself adding complexity to your code instead of simplifying it. And that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.